I believe in Douglas High School and the things for which it stands. Health in mind and body, service to others and to myself, social adjustment, economic security, and reverence for the spiritual. I believe in achievement and will continuously strive to accomplish what I set out to do. I believe in loyalty to our school and to its traditions. I pledge upon my honor to help in all its undertakings, in all that will make it a stronger and nobler school. And I promise to do all in my power to become a student to match its ideals. Dear old Douglas is the state of Oklahoma's oldest high school. Its legacy in the state is one of excellence and greatness that is second to none. It is a legacy that was ignited by racism and fueled by discrimination. From the day of the land run of 1889, the first black settlers in Oklahoma City were determined to give their children the best education possible in spite of Jim Crow laws designed to hold them back. After 2 years of schooling in churches and homes in the community, Douglas had its beginnings on a cold, snowy January morning in 1891, with a school year that was only 4 months long. The early years were difficult, but the school and the community were determined. Oklahoma City grew, and so did our school. Douglas soon became nationally known, and as the only black high school in the state's largest city, he was frequently visited by nationally known celebrities. Our school's greatness is the product of the many outstanding individuals who walked her hallways and sat in her classrooms, being continuously pushed to strive for excellence. Excellence that would be needed in a society that did not see them as equals. Douglas has had legendary principals. One of whom, Johnson Chestnut Whitaker, was the subject of a made-for-TV movie. The second black cadet at West Point Academy, Johnson was attacked by fellow white cadets. He was found unconscious, tied to his bed, his hands cut, and his ear nearly severed by a razor. He was accused of faking his injuries, and after a court-martial that drew national attention, was expelled. Douglas has had brilliant teachers who in turn produced thousands of outstanding students who went on to excel in virtually every aspect of American life. Two of her many notable graduates are honored on U.S. postage stamps, a nationally known award-winning novelist, and a Hall of Fame blues singer.
Sent for you yesterday, and baby, here you come today. Sent for you yesterday, and baby, here you come today. Baby, you can't love me and treat me that way.
Trojans have left their imprint on TV and Hollywood.
The Mueller Show.
Bill Jackson.
You know, honey, some people think you look like a cook stirring a pot. But to me, you look like the good fairy waving her magic wand.
Flattery will do you no good. What are you doing over here this time of day?
Put on the wrong pants this morning.
Continue, lover.
The other pants had my money in them.
Flag, it makes you free. So we sing the chorus from Atlanta to the sea. While we were marching to Georgia. Act like they won the war.
Please, just give me another chance.
You are a cop. Why don't you act like one? You come in here and you tell me some guy took your gun away from you? This is embarrassing. Angie runs away from you. You don't have a clue where the hell they manufacture the crack. Fiona sleeps with your husband? You're a mess. Look, I am sorry. I've got a department to run here.
Legendary and nationally known musicians.
Wow. Behind him is a fellow that's been with us for a number of years, George Moreland, on drums.
James Brown once told me, he said, man, and he just kind of shook his head. He said, man, I don't really understand it. He said, I look at TV and I see guys, you know, not really good at what they do, you know, and they're celebrities and they're stars. He said, when I was...
A Medal of Honor winner, courageous trailblazers, and nationally and internationally known athletes are among the graduates that have contributed to the greatness of Douglas, a greatness that continues to this very day.
So the story goes, my time's gone, so I've got to be getting away, on the AM side at least. Switching over to FM, and I certainly hope you've got a receiver, and I appreciate if you adjust your color. If you can't join it, be careful, baby. Button up your overcoat. The wind will blow free. Button up your coat. Take good care of you because you belong to me. See you tomorrow at 2:30. Meantime, friend, cross on over, okay? Put the calendar in one, Mama. I'll be home a little later on tonight. Friend, you ride easy, won't you?
Thank you.
Douglas has produced 7 coaches that have been inducted into the Oklahoma Coaches Association Hall of Fame. Collectively, they in turn produced hundreds of athletes that went on to perform at the collegiate and professional levels. Integration of public accommodations in Oklahoma City was accomplished primarily with Douglas students. Under the guidance of Mrs. Clara Looper, Douglas Trojans were the backbone of the nation's longest continual series of protests against discrimination manned mostly by high school students. Beginning in 1958, the sit-ins and marches would continue until the passage of the National Civil Rights Bill by Congress in 1964. The first steps of our school's journey down the path of greatness began in an inconspicuous place in the middle of the downtown Myriad Gardens. The south side of the pond, where it is crossed by the Crystal Bridge, is the exact spot where Douglas's history began in 1891. It was housed in a 2-room barn-like building in the back of an abandoned wagon yard at what was then the southwest corner of California and Harvey Streets. It was simply called the Colored School, and only went to the 5th grade. It had 18 students and 2 teachers, one of whom was Principal J.D. Randolph. A year later, it was moved across the street, 1 block to the east, because of the foul odor from the next door livery stable. In 1898, Douglas was moved to a new 2-story, 8-room frame building on the corner of California and Gary Streets. It was here that the name Douglas was chosen by the students in honor of the great civil rights leader, Frederick Augustus Douglas. Douglas became a high school, graduating its first class in 1903. Three months after that first graduation ceremony, the school was destroyed in a fire where arson was suspected. Today's Bricktown Event Center sits at the location. The following school year, Douglas was moved to a formerly white school, Webster. It would be Douglas's home for the next 31 years. It was a home that in the beginning was a bit frightening for some of the students. The school was constructed on the site of what had been the city's first cemetery. And although all the graves had long since been removed, some students felt a need for protection from the spooks and haints arising from the ground. To keep from having bad luck, many of the students wore good luck charms made of rabbit's foot and milkweed. In 1923, the legendary Zelia Page Grow, daughter of Principal Inman Page, formed the school's first band. Over the years, the band performed and received praise locally, statewide, and nationally, including the 1933 World's Fair in Chicago. Among her students were Jimmy Rushing, Charlie Christian, and Ralph Ellison. In addition to starting the Douglas Choral and Orchestral programs, she also organized the citywide May Day celebration for Oklahoma City's African American children, at which the Douglas Band performed. Her musical influence was so profound that her funeral at Avery Chapel AME Church was attended by Duke Ellington and Count Basie. In spite of, and as a reaction to the adverse social conditions during her early years, Douglas produced many outstanding classes, notably the class of 1931. Of its 52 graduates, five would go on to earn doctorate degrees during their careers. The class also included the award-winning novelist Ralph Ellison and Oklahoma City's first black municipal judge, Albert Alexander. Today, the Bricktown Baseball Park occupies the site. As time passed, several factors created a need for a new school location. The building itself was badly in need of repair. The school's enrollment had grown to more than 800 students, while the city's black population had spread north and eastward. In addition, there was a notorious red light district just east of the school. Any student caught walking through it risked being spanked. This forced students to take the long way to and from school over the Walnut Street Bridge. In 1934, Douglas was moved to Northeast 6th and High. It was here, in 1935, that the school mascot name was changed from Red Machine to Trojans, and the school creed and fight song were written by students. Under the leadership of F.D. Moon, the emphasis on community involvement and academics accelerated. Night classes were offered at the Adult Institute and the Veterans School, and for a while, there was even a Douglas Junior College housed in the building. Twenty years later, in 1954, Douglas was moved to the former State Fairgrounds at Northeast 8th and Eastern, where it remains today. And with it came the now deeply rooted tradition of striving for excellence. Excellence not only in the academic, vocational, and extracurricular endeavors, but also in the social issues that historically have impacted our school and our community. Today, the demographic changes in the city have brought change to our school, but the legacy, the traditions, indeed the history itself, have been forever ingrained into the fabric of Douglas, where it merges with the present and the future. We'll be right back.
There you go. That's what we did.
Get him, Josh. Get him, Josh.
Mike, Mike.
I didn't know this.
Say it to you, Mike.
Is always better. We look back and we think the winters were warmer, the grass was greener, the skies were bluer, and smiles were bright. Can it be that it was all so simple then? Or has time rewritten every line? And if we had the chance to do it all again, tell me, would we, could we, memories like the corners of my mind, misty watercolor memories of the way we were. Scattered pictures of the smiles we left behind, smiles we gave to one another for the way
we were. Can it be that it was all so simple then? Or has time rewritten every line? And if we had the chance to do it all again, tell me, would we? What's too painful to remember? We simply choose to forget. So with the laughter, we will remember. Whenever we
desert heat, a summer heat.